Hello, folks. It's been long promised, but it is finally time, I think. So, we are going to be doing Gateway to the Savage Frontier. Oh, look at those colors. Yon Software and SSI. So this is not a Westwood Studios, it looks like. Oh, when did I first play this game? Let's see, when did this sucker come out? Came out in 1991. That would have been before I had a PC. Don't think I had a PC yet in 91. I want to say it was 92 before we got a PC. But, so I'm pretty sure I played this on the Commodore 64, this and its sequel, Treasures of the Savage Frontier. So, we will be playing. We'll be playing Demo Man here, just for the intro. This is going to be a very short one. This will be a preview. I have created the party, but I've still got to do a little bit of tweaking. So, looking at the game itself will, looking at the intro will be just here with Demo Man, as is tradition. Celebration! Party has successfully protected the caravan from Citadel Adbar all the way to Yartar. Well, hell. Good on us. Better yet, we've been paid. Can Demo Man really eat 5 big steaks in one sitting? Demo Man is a manly dwarf. He can eat 10 big steaks. Insights of the Eating as the introduction to our journal. Oh, my goodness. Oh, this is a long one. All right, so, the introduction to our journal. As you can see, it's quite a bit of text. I am not going to make you read. I will read this for you, I think. We had thought this was going to be a routine mission, guarding a caravan of mithril traveling from Citadel Abdar in the far north. But no sooner did we sign on to provide protection than the dwarves' king, Harbom, himself called us to the top of the tallest tower in the fortress. Now Harbom, he talks through his great whiskers, and it sounds like a bellows blowing, but this particular morning he didn't have to say much to get our attention. He pointed to the northeast, and we looked towards a brown cloud floating above one of the mountain valleys. "Do you see that? It is dust," he said, his voice rising. "It's the dust of tens of thousands of Ice Mountain orcs as they march from their caves towards the cities of the south." "But that always happens this time of year," someone replied. "Orc raiding parties are always attacking Sundabar or ambushing caravans from Silvery Moon." The old dwarf nodded. "Aye, that's true. But turn your eyes to that dark cloud once more. Is that the dust of 1,000 raiders? I think not. 2,000? By no means. If we are lucky, perhaps only 2,000 times 10. Or, 20,000. You could have just said 20,000. "Guard well this caravan, adventurers," he told us. "Evil is again awakened in the realms, and its eyes and hands and daggers will be all around you." Well, after that speech, you can imagine how worried we all were. Every step of the way, we scanned the horizon, looking for those dark brown clouds. We didn't see any, but we sure heard a lot of stories. Seems like everyone in the Northern Realms knows someone who's seen at least a dozen trolls or 100 orcs skulking across their fields. Burly fighter by the bar called out, "See, you came all this way with such a fine-looking sword, never had a chance to quench it with orcish blood." His voice dripping with sarcasm, he mimicked a dancer tiptoeing across a stage. "Perhaps you didn't want to fight. Perhaps it's just a child's toy with a fine golden handle attached to it for show." Before his words had even crossed the room, the sword in question was drawn, its gleaming blade flashing even in the dim light of the tavern. The room went silent as they waited to see if we'd attack the blustering fool. After a moment of hesitation, the sword was sheathed again. "This sword is saved for orcish blood," we called back to the drunken fighter. "We do not care to soil it with yours." Men looked at us, thought for a minute, realized he'd been insulted, and started to cross the room. Hesitating, he looked around. To his surprise, none of his companions were crossing with him. He started to admonish them, call them to battle, but the words were stilled in his throat. A tall, thin, black-caped man was sitting in the corner. Of course he was. And he shook his head one time. The drunken fighter dropped his eyes to the floor, muttered something, then turned and left the tavern. Several others followed. There was another moment of awkward silence. The man in the corner nodded, and the waitress appeared with a heaping tray, crying, "More for everyone! It's on the house!" We all surged forward for our share, and the rest of the evening was full of great fun and storytelling. Hell yeah, that's our intro. No, I don't know what the hell that voice I was doing was. But the next day, you awaken to despair. Oh no! The merrymaking at the tavern made one too many friends in a town famous for the dexterity of its thieves, and now everything is gone! Looking around the room filled with anger, you record your feelings as journal entry number 5. Now let me scroll down, because... hang on, I'm almost to the journal entries. "A curse upon their filthy heads. They've taken all we had, stolen everything save the clothes on our backs. More, more for everyone," the waitress cried out last night. We looked at each other, shamefaced at having fallen for so old a trick. Someone slipped a little something in our food, and we slept like contented babies while the bandits stole us blind. All the gold earned on our last mission is gone. We endured those dangers, did our jobs, and now left with empty pockets. Our heads could have festooned the end of an orcish pike, all for nothing. They even took my fine magical sword with the gold braided handle. The one I used to slay the griffin at Lawnsaddle last winter. What I would give to have it one more time, if only to skewer the slime who committed this atrocity. We still have a tiny purse of coins I kept beneath my pillow. There isn't much. There isn't much? Dude, it's 35 platinum. Presumably per person. That's a fortune. But it'll be enough to buy new weapons and a few supplies. We need to find a new sponsor or a new mission quickly to earn the money we need to live. Whatever mission we next accept, we will have a second quest to complete as well. To catch those thieves and exact payment for last night. Scut! Alright, so. Right. So here we are. Bum, 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 bum. We are in Gulash, Yontur, something like that. However, as you can see, since this was 1991, the art is improved. I mean, it looks a lot better. Now, hey, we can get into a bar fight. I mean, it's much more varied, too. How much are weapons? However, we do still have the, Volge. We still have the endless pole arm lists. Gisimar Volge, Gisimar Glaive, Glissimar Glaive, Glaive Glaive, Gisimar Glaive, Glissimar Glaive, Volge. Yeah. Still have all that nonsense. Looking to train. So, there we go. Gateway to the Savage Frontier. Next episode, we will have our party, which we will introduce. Since you start at level 2, I'm not going to do like I did with Curse, where I basically had everyone except the Paladin and Ranger multi-class, because it's not really worth it for the mages. I mean, it'll get them another 20 hit points, but I don't want to spend all day trying to level mages with bar fights. Especially since it looks like I'll only be fighting 3. I will, however, do it for the thief. Mainly because thieves are really kind of bad in these games, but useful. So, leveling up a thief won't take too long. I'll do that off camera. That'll all be done by the time we start. So when we pick up with episode 1, we will have a full party and we will begin exploring whatever the hell the name of the city is. Yartar. Yeah, it's going to be fun with the names. But until next time, folks, have a good one.